Okay, so we're gonna do something a little bit different over here since I understand that I've been getting a lot of fucking complaints over my fucking audio. So what I've decided to do is that I am gonna be pulling a quite here and I am gonna be holding the microphone to see how well you guys can understand my fucking audio quality since I get that so much. So we're gonna try that, see if you like it, and if not, well, whatever. So let us begin the intro now, shall we? Throughout human history, we have all had our folk heroes and our tall tales. This can go for works of fiction or real life heroes of human history. As in for fiction, you had such people like Paul Bunyan, Casey Jones, John Henry, Robin Hood stealing from the rich and the poor, as well as King Arthur and his Knights of the Round Table. And in reality, throughout human history, you had such heroes like Leonidas and his 300 Spartans, our homeboy Xenophon. I gotta re-edit that fucking video, by the way. Miyamoto Musashi, Alphonse Capone, depending on who you talk to, New Jack. So you get it. You have like, people with the tall tales, the folk heroes, or anti-folk heroes, depending on who you ask. But during the last decade, one man became such a hero to those that were the voiceless. His lack of sexual companionship made him absolutely furious. He was frustrated, disgruntled, and humiliated over his lack of sexual prowess. That due to his actions, he would become a voice for the unfuckable, the unlovable, the undesirable. He was the supreme gentleman.
It all has to come to this. Tomorrow is the day of retribution, the day in which I will have my revenge against humanity, against all of you.
Oh yes, we are talking about him, Elliot Rodger.
A date which will live in infamy.
Hey everybody, this is Atticus the Death Miller, and welcome to the real-life debut episode of 2023's Death Metal Historian Series, aka the bootleg version of Absolute Mad Lads. And on this episode, yes, we are doing an episode on the supreme gentleman, the king of the incels, the ultimate loser himself, Elliot Rodger. I know a lot of you people are going to be saying this. Well, there are two reasons why I am making this video. Number one, this day happens to be the 10th anniversary of my channel. And so I want to do a very special episode of the Death Metal Historian to commemorate on this whole case. And number two, another reason why I chose Elliot Rodger is because, well, Elliot just so happens to play a very crucial, important role into my development as a person, as well as how I'm here where I am right now on this channel. And why do you ask that? Well, Varg, take it from here.
Well, let's find out.
Elliot Oliver Rodger was born in London, England on July 24th, 1991. His father, Peter Rodger, was a filmmaker known mostly being involved with the Hunger Games franchise, and his mother, Lee Chin, was a nurse who also worked on film sets. He also had a younger sister named Georgia. By the time Elliot turned to the age of five, his family moved across the pond in the US in 1996. There, he would reside in Los Angeles, California. This move would be beneficial for Peter. Specifically, it would strengthen his film career. After settling in, Elliot was off to elementary school, starting a new life in America. By all standards, Elliot was a well-behaved kid, developing friends and enjoying himself. But there would be a setback. A lot of setbacks. As he turned 7, his first of many struggles in life happened. Peter and Lee Chin would unfortunately divorce, resulting in a new woman to enter in his life, actress Sumoya Akabun. There, they married. Though he was happy most of his young life, he was described as very shy and lacking in confidence. He tried to make up for that by trying to fit in with the cool kids. Kinda like me. Elliot would often argue with Sumoya, which would be a reoccurring thing for many years to come. Despite all this, Elliot was rich. I mean, loaded. Given his father's career in Hollywood, it all makes sense that Elliot lived a very affluent life, taking several holidays abroad, having access to healthcare, general and mental. But given on what we know of him, he would not be eager on taking the mental side of his health. Despite on having easy access to almost everything, his friendship circles were deteriorating as he reached his teens, thus becoming a frequent target for bullies. Situations at home would grow more complicated as well. By the time Elliot was 13, Sumoya gave birth to Elliot's half-brother, Jazz. Now, it's all natural to feel that you're not getting a lot of love and attention from your parents when there are younger siblings involved, and I feel this way that my second cousin, Emery's not getting a lot of attention from me when I visit, so I make sure that she's given a lot of love and attention from me when I visit. But this is Elliot Rodger that we are talking about. And we have established that he does not have a good relationship with his stepmother. In his mid-teens, he would create a YouTube channel called Elliot's Blog, where a good majority of the video, we are going to cover a lot of his videos. I sincerely apologize for the cringe that you are about to witness regarding his videos. In 2007, he was diagnosed with pervasive development disorder. Okay, this is getting really fucking weird because I also have pervasive development disorder. Aside from that, Elliot would continue being bullied. At Crespi Carmelite High, he was bullied in one incident. His head was taped to a desk while he was asleep. According to Rodger in 2012, the one friend he had in the whole world who truly understood him said he didn't want to be friends anymore, without offering any reason, to which it's pretty sad. But remember, again, this is Elliot Rodger we are talking about. This bullying would cause him to move school to school to escape from his tormentors, sadly not making a whole lot of friends in the process. There on his YouTube channel, he would often, if not always, talk about his loneliness, rejection, and would remiss about his childhood.
Elliot Rodger here. And here I am at Sarania Park. The most significant place of my childhood.
After turning 18, Rodger began rejecting mental health care and became increasingly isolated. He said that he was unable to make friends, although acquaintances said that he rebuffed their attempts to being friendly. Family friend Dale Loner said that he counseled Rodger on approaching women, but Rodger did not follow the advice. Loner also commented that when he met Rodger at 8 or 9, I can see that there was something wrong with him. Looking back now, he strikes me as someone who was broken from the moment of conception. Have to agree. He was prescribed risperidone, which was often to treat schizophrenia, but Elliot hated it, stating, after doing research, it was the worst thing for me to take. He last attended Independence Continuation High School in Lake Balboa, from where he graduated in 2009. Rodger then briefly enrolled in Los Angeles Pierce College and Moore Park College before ultimately transferring to Santa Barbara City College in 2011. There, he resided in Isla Vista, where he had 2 roommates. There, this is how Elliot would develop from a lonely, affluent loser to the supreme gentleman we all know and hate. Elliot decided to improve himself by moving forward, by learning 2 things. 1, learning how to drive and obtain his license. And 2, to dress better, so that he can look like a top G. I'm sorry, but having a fine-ass Bugatti and fine designer clothes does not mean jack shit, unless you have something that a lot of women do love in a guy, charisma. He desperately tried this move to make more friends. Despite having a new and improved look, he never made any effort into actually conversing or talking to people. Instead, sit in his car on lunch breaks and hope that people would make the first move. That's not how you make friends, you fucking dumbass. This is also where he would make his sad boy vlogs in the mix.
This world, it's so twisted. It's so cruel. And you girls make it cruel. Elliot Rodger here. I'm just sitting in my car right now, enjoying the view of the beach. And my view has been ruined by this sight right here. In front of me, sitting right there on that bench, is a young couple. I was enjoying such a nice view until they came and sat down and started kissing. This is the reason why life isn't fair. Why can't I experience something like that? I have to show everyone why I hate the world. Because no girl would do this with me. I hate them. I hate them so much. It's not fair. Life is not fair.
Well, yeah, dude, life is not fair. Life is not your oyster. Plus, you're a fucking loser, bruh. His whole life was pretty lonely too, where he would spend time playing World of Warcraft and Halo with his clique of online friends. Thus, he began to recognize that he was angry at the world. Angry over his stepmom, his insecurities, and struggles. But most importantly, he was furious. Absolutely fucking furious that he was not getting any strange. Yeah, he was upset that he did not get laid. His views on people became increasingly toxic. He would admit on his journal every time he would see a couple holding hands or kissing, he would feel sadness or utter virgin rage. This resulted in him lashing out. In 2011, he threw coffee on a couple he was jealous of. He claims in another incident he splashed coffee on two girls who were not smiling at him. In 2012, Roger used a super soaker filled with orange juice to spray a group playing kickball at Gersh Park. Yeah, I'm pretty sure from all these three instances, especially the third one, he got his ass rightfully whooped. I'm calling it. He got his ass rightfully fucking whooped. This would fester and grow even worse. His first two roommates moved out, but his two new roommates made things even worse for him. There he would argue with them daily. Also, I forgot to mention that Elliot was sort of racist for being Asian. It's funny because, you know, Elliot is Eurasian and he was the product of an interracial relationship. So, by fucking default, you can't be racist because you're a product of an interracial marriage. But yet you're still a fucking idiot. His longing for a big titty blonde girl also lingered. He would often head back to his place where he would sulk and cry like the little bitch after seeing a normal couple walk by. In 2012, he decided to drop all of his classes because, quote, he could not bear the sight of couples falling in love.
I'm so angry right now. I was enjoying a peaceful time at this beach park. And what comes to sit in front of me? A young couple, a guy with his hot girlfriend. I mean, who do they think they are? Coming here, sitting in front of me to make me feel jealous? This is the reason why I hate the world. This is getting too out of hand. I can't go anywhere anymore without seeing these young couples getting jealous and, you know, having them remind me of what I'm lacking in life.
Jesus Christ, man, you really are a fucking loser. Elliot also began an unhealthy habit of buying lottery tickets in hopes of winning more money to get all the bitches, spending over $100 on lottery tickets. And of course, he did not win. Go figure. But this was not going to stop him. Next week, he decided to spend $500 on lottery tickets. Again, he lost. The next, he spent $700. Third time's a charm. He lost. But what was worse, that he did not accept defeat. Shortly after, he experienced one of the worst bouts of depression in his life. As spring break rolled up on the corner, he spent most of it locked up in his room. And for the times he would go outside, he would vlog taking hikes alone, talking about how alone he was. In April 2012, one of Elliot's closest friends, James, decided that enough was enough, finding Elliot too radical, negative, and toxic, calling the friendship off. Well, I really do not blame James for that. Elliot, by then, was truly and literally alone. One night, Elliot drank an entire bottle of wine, where he unfortunately got some of the wine on his laptop. The next day, he would go to the local Best Buy to purchase a new one. As they were preparing his new order, he decided to walk around and spend some time at a nearby shooting range. Foreshadowing's a bitch. At this time, Elliot would have thoughts of acting out on a day. A day of retribution. A day where Elliot would simply have had enough and unleash his wrath upon the women that had wronged him or did not get him any sort of attention. And it was at this moment at the fire range that Elliot said to himself, "What am I doing here? How could things have led to this?" Though this question was hesitant, it appeared that he had his mind made up. He came to the conclusion that humans are just animals. Animals that need to be put down. If he could not coexist with them, he would have to kill them all. He purchased a Glock 34 in December 2012, and the following year purchased a Sig Sauer P226. He was planning on doing something major. All of this festering anger and hatred wasn't bad enough. The breaking point happened in July 20th, 2013. Elliot attended a party where, of course, he tried to make attempts to interact with girls. Before the past 2 weeks, he had been working out in his room to improve on his physique. Which, good on you, man. Really good. But gains are really not going to make an impression unless you got charisma. Again, you fucking bozo. With every attempt, he was slightly ignored. In his intoxicated state, he stood on a 10-foot ledge where some peers were hanging out. Now, knowing Elliot and what we know how he is, we can assume that one thing led to another where he got into an argument, resulting in a fight. This was escalated where he attempted to push girls off the ledge. He failed miserably, where the end result was him being pushed off the ledge by men who intervened. He survived, but resulted in a broken ankle. When he went back for his sunglasses, he was again mocked and beaten. A neighbor saw Roger come home crying and vowing to kill the men involved and then himself. This very moment was where the straw definitely broke the camel's back. This was where this affluent and privileged loser would plan on his day of retribution. But before we get into that, I'm just gonna pull a little bit of a Matt Walsh over here and try to answer the question, what is an incel? Cue the next segment. So, oh my god, I just compared myself to Matt Walsh. But again, we're gonna be talking about what is an incel. To those of you who already know, like we all know what an incel is, but to those who are of the older generations who do not have internet access or living under Dwayne Johnson, this is the segment to all of you guys. So, all of you are gonna be asking me, what is an incel? Incel is an acronym for the term involuntarily celibate or involuntarily celibacy, which in hindsight means you cannot get laid, you cannot get any poontang, you cannot get any pussy, like you are absolutely undesirable physically, mentally, you cannot get any pussy at all whatsoever. So that is what an incel is described, what the acronym is. But what makes an incel? Well, it can be over the genetics, over having one or two parents that are butt ugly. It could also result into living in low income or in poverty. It could also result into having like physical or mental disabilities. Like for instance, Elliot had pervasive development disorder. So in hindsight, now I'm not saying this to anybody, but in hindsight, a good majority of incels are on the spectrum. Not all of them, and I am pretty sure that a lot of men on the spectrum do get laid. This is a factor. But for Elliot's case and of other people on the spectrum that are incels, yes, they do become incels. Incels tend to really don't take a lot of very good advice, as in, just trying to booster your diet, try to talk with a lot of people more, try to interact with people, try to overcome your insecurities, your loneliness, just try to be comfortable into integrating with a lot of people, try not to make everything about yourself, a lot of very helpful stuff. Incels tend to just take all that good advice and throw it out the fucking window, and they expect all the hard work into obtaining a girlfriend to be sent over to them. They demand that society wants, you know, women to like fall for these absolute losers, when in fact no it isn't. Like, life isn't really fair because women mostly go for like really attractive men or women. Like other women. So, I mean, there's all that. I really, 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 really fucking am sick and fucking tired over people calling Andrew Tate an incel. Now, I know that a lot of people do not like Andrew Tate. I find him to be an absolute clown as well. But to call Andrew Tate an incel is absolutely disingenuous as fuck. Because as much as you all hate Andrew Tate, he is not an incel. He is not an incel in any shape or form whatsoever. How do I know this? Well, I mean, look at him. He is the fucking top G. And of course, he gets a lot of strain. So to go around and say that he's an incel is not only wrong, it's also fucking disingenuous. Also, not to mention, you're gonna go around and say the term incel over people that you do not like, that are men that actually do get laid. So you're gonna be basically claiming any guy that you do not like is an incel. Kind of like everybody you do not like is either racist, sexist, misogynist, transphobe, homophobe, bigot, all that shit. So it's kind of like that. Or also Nazi. Yeah, also Nazi. So as well as like soy boys, lib shards, woke, all that shit. So yeah, you're kind of not only misusing the term incel, you're applying it to basically kill the term incel. So yeah, go fuck yourselves for that. And I still don't like Andrew Tate. Where do incels congregate, you might be asking me? A lot of incels take their time online, mostly into places like 4chan, Reddit, or other like forums, where they basically have this culture where they all flip the fuck out and they just cry, piss, bitch, and moan, and then talk about some very fucked up shit, which later down the line we'll get into. But yes, you can find most incels on 4chan, on Reddit, or any sort of like forum sites. It's crazy. It's really crazy. But yeah, Elliot is considered an incel because he has a learning disability. He has the insecurities. He has the history of being bullied. He has the mental illness as well. That is what makes up an incel, amongst other things. You could be rich like Elliot Rodger, or you could be poor and you can be an incel. Like, incelism does not know any class whatsoever. So thank you all for coming to my TED Talk, my crash course onto what makes an incel. Now, let's move on to the topic. It is 2014, and Elliot was collectively making preparations for his day of retribution. Elliot spent most of those final months outside of his room, mostly going on hikes in Montecito and long strolls on the beach, which are actually really fun and good activities. If you were brainstorming on a fucking rampage, he would often do these activities not just to clear his head or plan his attack, but also contemplate his very existence.
Hey, Elliot Rodger here. Right now I'm just taking a walk through the park in this really nice, secluded area. I'm just contemplating about my life and how unfair it's been lately. Ever since I started desiring girls, but they never desired me back. Life has been a living hell since then. Right now it's spring break. Everyone else my age is out having fun with their friends and their girlfriends. Here I am, taking lonely walks through a park.
Oh, cry me a fucking river, you incel. So you remember that video that I shared earlier of that couple at the beach? Yeah, well, most of his videos did not gain any traction whatsoever, and it was largely ignored by a lot of people. But one person viewed it and became very worried that Elliot was unstable, which he was. The person called a health agency, which then informed the police. The police went to check up on Elliot and talked to him outside of his bedroom, questioning him if he was having any thoughts of suicide. But giving on how Elliot somehow used his +9 in charisma on two supposed brain dead cops, he told them everything was A-okay. Reminder, ACAB. This worked in Elliot's favor because if they decided to investigate his room, not only would they find his two handguns and ammunition, they would find his infamous fucking manifesto. His manifesto was titled My Twisted World, which contained over 107,000 words. His manifesto described his already established struggles with trying to slay pussy, his hatred of women, alpha males, racism. In one part of the manifesto, he said, "How can an inferior, ugly black boy be able to get a white girl and not me? I am beautiful, and I am half white myself. I am descended from British aristocracy. He is descended from slaves. On the day before the day of retribution, I will start the first phase of my vengeance, silently killing as many people as I can around Isla Vista by luring them into my apartment through some form of trickery. Elliot, I think it's because not only does he have a great personality and charisma, it's also because he's packing down there. His second phase was his utter war on women, describing that it will take place on the day of retribution itself, just before the climactic massacre. My war on women, I will attack the very girls who represent everything I hate. The female gender, the hottest sorority of USSB. Roger stated in his manifesto that in his ideal world, he would quarantine all women in concentration camps. At these camps, the vast majority of the female population will be deliberately starved to death. This would be an efficient and fitting way to kill them all. I would have an enormous tower built just for myself and gleefully watch them all die. Jesus Christ, I can see this as like a slam band album cover, bro. He also dreamed of a pure world where a man's mind can develop to greater heights than ever before. Future generations will live their lives free of having to worry about the barbarity of sex and women, which will enable them to expand their intelligence and advance the human race to a state of perfect civilization. He said that he planned to kill his half-brother and stepmother, but was not mentally prepared to kill his father. His plan was to take down his two roommates, George Chen Chengyun, Chen Yun Hong, on day one. On day two, he would then march over to the Alpha Phi sorority house, where he would describe it having the most beautiful and desirable white women of Isla Vista, where he would commit a murderous rampage upon them. And after that, he would then move over to Del Playa Drive in his car before crushing anyone as possible. And after his body count was to his liking, he would bite the bullet. Everything was set. Everything was underway for Roger. But before he could execute his day of retribution, he would have to shoot one final video. Yep, you all know the one.
Hi, Elliot Rodger here. Well, this is my last video. It all has to come to this. Tomorrow is the day of retribution. The day in which I will have my revenge against humanity. Against all of you. I'm 22 years old, and I'm still a virgin. It has been very torturous. It's not fair. You girls have never been attracted to me. I don't know why you girls aren't attracted to me, but I will punish you all for it. I don't know what you don't see in me. I'm the perfect guy, and yet you throw yourselves at all these obnoxious men instead of me, the supreme gentleman. I will punish all of you for it. You will finally see that I am, in truth, the superior one. The true alpha male. Yes. Well, now, I will be a god compared to you. You will all be animals. You denied me a happy life. And in turn, I will deny all of you life. It's only fair. I hate all of you. I've waited a long time for this. I can't wait to give you exactly what you deserve. Utter annihilation.
The day of retribution was in full swing. And no one was gonna fucking stop him. Elliot Rodger began his attacks at his apartment. There he attacked both of his roommates, as we explained earlier, stabbing them multiple times. Bloodstains later found the building's hallway suggested that Rodger had attacked one or more of his victims. As they entered, a bloody bath towel and paper towels in the bathroom suggests that Rodger had attempted to clean the hallway. The men's position suggested that each was killed separately as they entered. Another victim, sadly, was one of his roommate's friends named Weihan Wang. After the stabbings, Roger purchased coffee at a coffee shop. At around 8:30 p.m., he was seen working on his laptop in his car in the parking lot of his apartment building. He uploaded his retribution video at 9:17 p.m. and sent his manifesto email at 9:18 p.m. After receiving a copy of his manifesto, Roger's therapist phoned his mother, who, finding the retribution video on Roger's YouTube channel, contacted Roger's father. In separate cars, his parents left Los Angeles for Santa Barbara, calling Isla Vista police en route. Roger drove to the Alpha Phi sorority house, where he knocked on the front door for a few minutes. Thankfully, the women inside were smart enough to keep it locked, or that it was a sorority house where they had a certain code for people to come inside. Thus, Elliot went over to Plan B, which he went guns fucking blazing. He then began shooting people nearby. Two women were killed and a third was injured. Roger then began driving again, firing into an unoccupied coffee shop on Paradil Road, then several times into a delicatessen.
911, what's the address of your emergency?
I'm at IV Deli. You guys think somebody else is on the line.
Okay.
I don't know what happened.
Okay. Were you injured? Were you injured?
I'm shot.
Okay, where are you?
Somebody else's. We're at IV Deli in Isla Vista.
Okay, you're at IV Deli and somebody shot?
Yeah.
Okay.
A man was struck seven times and killed. Roger drove south on Embarcadero del Norte on the wrong side of the street, striking a pedestrian and firing two people on the sidewalk, missing them. He shot a couple exiting a pizzeria and a female cyclist. He drove south on El Embarcadero and shot at and missed a woman, turned east on Del Playa Drive, and made a U-turn to drive west. He then exchanged fire with a sheriff's deputy responding to a telephone report and struck two pedestrians. Turning north on Camino del Sur, Roger shot and wounded three people at Sabado Tarde Street and struck a skateboarder and two cyclists with his car. Turning east on Sabado Tarde, he struck another skateboarder with his car and shot two other men on intersection with Camino Pesadero on Sabado Tarde near Little Acorn Park. Roger exchanged gunfire with three sheriff's deputies and was shot in the hip. Pursued by police, he turned south a second time onto El Embarcadero and then west again on Del Playa. He struck a cyclist, then crashed on the north sidewalk just east of the intersection of Del Playa and Camino Pesadero. At 9:35 p.m., police found Roger dead inside his car from a self-inflicted gunshot wound to his head. He was 22 years at the time of his death. Finally, the mayhem stopped, and the supreme gentleman was dead. But at what cost? Elliot Rodger's rampage resulted in 7 deaths and 14 injured from gunfire and his car. Students and community members gathered at Ensanyo Park in Isla Vista on the evening of May 24th for a candlelight memorial to remember the victims. 20,000 people attended a memorial service at UCSB's Harder Stadium on May 27th. Peter Rodger expressed on how he felt in an interview not long after his rampage.
How are you?
Every night I go to sleep, I wake up, and I think of those young men and young women that have died, and they were injured and were terrorized. And my son did that.
And much like that of Lionel Dahmer, I still to this very day feel so bad for Peter Rodger. I really fucking do. Now, if all you remembered after the attacks, a hashtag on Twitter was shared around called Yes All Women. In many ways, this was a precursor to the Me Too movement, where it had to spread further awareness on how misogyny, even in the first world, is still rampant despite on how much progress we have made. A detractor of this was the hashtag Not All Men, which, yes, I do agree, not all men. You are watching this video yourself, and you say to yourself that you're a good man, right? Which I'm not saying that you're a horrible person, but you have to ask the very hard question on what a woman has to deal with every single day of her life. You can ask every woman you know, even your mother, sister, cousin, aunt, grandmother, etc. They'll probably tell you that yes, they have had some very, very, very negative experiences with men. Men like Elliot Rodger. Now, back in the day when I saw this hashtag, I saw this as a personal attack on all men. But we will get to me in the past later. I also remembered that there was a petition signed by the White House to classify the men's rights activists as terrorists. Again, we will talk about that later. But in the long run, the Yes All Women hashtag was to spread awareness that women experience sexism and misogyny every day. But that hashtag was overshadowed over the Black Lives Matter and Me Too hashtag grassroots movements. Now, the factor that the MRAs were classified as a terrorist group was seen as absolutely laughable. But they were all further from the truth, for the real enemy was lurking in the underbelly of the internet. And with Elliot Rodger's death, he gave them all a voice. And they were all going to rise up in rebellion. Elliot Rodger's acts were truly heinous and horrific. There is no denying that. Now, usually the whole world would collectively agree that what Elliot did was irreprehensible, unforgivable, disgusting. But a small but growing faction on the internet learned of what he did. They instead celebrated and loved on what he did. Now, back in the day, I called these people symptoms, nice guy initis, as a joke. But in 2018, they would have an official term for their affection. On April 23rd, 2018, 25-year-old Alec Manassian pushed the gas pedal on a moving van in downtown Toronto, where he went on a road rampage, killing 11 people and injuring 15. He just so happened to be the acquaintance to Elliot and proclaimed on an online post that the incel rebellion had begun. Thus, the term incel was mainstream. On August 12th, 2021, Plymouth, England, 22-year-old Jake Davison went on a murderous rampage, killing 6 people, injuring 2, before pulling the trigger to his head with a shotgun. He too was motivated by the incel ideology. And recently, with the incident with Jacob Yerkes in late 2022, people are now understanding on how toxic and dangerous this online ideology is, being classified as not just a death cult by some, but also a possible domestic terrorist threat. With Elliot's martyrdom, he has become a folk hero and a god to these men who have fallen off the deep end and want to watch the world burn. Now, I know you want me to end the video on this note, but I know all of you are asking me this very important question to yours truly. Atticus the Death Meddler, how does this absolute loser tie into you? Well, I'm glad you asked, because this is where we are going to enter our next segment. Now, I know you are curious on why yours truly has some connection with Elliot Rodger. In a way, Elliot Rodger was the big break that jumpstarted my crazy career on YouTube, and also in a way helped me not become an incel. Let me explain. Now, if you must know that yes, I'm still a virgin, I'm not ashamed to admit that, and I'm okay with that. But back in the day, I was basically online making so many online posts on Facebook on woe is me, why am I single, that I would feel hurt every time I would see a couple hold hands and kiss. I desperately wanted to find love, but I would always be falling for the women that was way above my standards, or that they just knew of my condition and would not want to pursue a romantic relationship with someone with a learning disability, which in a way I could understand because, well, women have standards. Coupled with my many feminists going after my posts just to make fun and heckle me on my online shenanigans, and even when I started my YouTube channel, I really did not know what the hell I was talking about. And mostly vented my frustrations on feminism, being inspired by YouTubers like The Amazing Atheist and WarCorp666. But after the rampage Elliot Rodger made, this was a huge reality check after seeing what he posted. This was enough to spur off my self-pity and realize that this is not the path that I really did not want to go through. Now, before he did that, he left a manifesto saying that, oh, I've never gotten laid, I'm 22 and I'm still a virgin, and you know, all the jocks go after, like all the chicks go after all the jocks who are total douchebags and stuff, and they don't go after a nice guy like me. Well, let me tell you this, cuz, I'm 22 myself, I'm a virgin, and no, I do not go around, do not go around in my school deciding to shoot up all the girls that rejected me. I've been rejected so much in my life, especially in high school. But you know what? I sucked it up and I moved on. Basically, your mind was not right in there. It was going to be a path that was going to be filled with nothing but hatred and more depression. Ever since I posted that video, I gained attention of the ranting community. And boy, oh boy, did my life change after that. This was where I made my first collab and developed an amazing friendship with Official GATG, aka Stoutmeister, whom is now in the band Aperion Bound, which I recommend you fucking check that band out, please. As well as making friendships with other crazy, wacky characters of the ranting community. Some friendships have endured, and others not so much. And with me growing up, as well as my views changing, I can safely say that I've become a better, mature, and stronger person than I was. Back then, I hated feminism. And today, I have fully embraced it. I wanted so badly to hate women, But now, and still to this day, I make sure as possible that I love and respect them. And who knows, someday, if I manage to get a hold of my insecurities and get my chances, I might have a woman whom will love and cherish to be with me every single day. And that to me is a big, monumental middle finger to Elliot Rodger. And before I end this portion of the script, Elliot, I must say this to you. Elliot, you were born a loser, and you have died a loser. Your followers don't mean shit to you, even if they simped over to your lonely fans beating up to your one-inch dick. Your crown is made of tin foil and paper mache. You make farts that make even the lowest standard women die from your putrid stench. Elliot, I hope you found love. Love over a huge hulking succubus transvestite with a hulking 16-inch studded penis ramming your asshole for all eternity. In hell. And with that, Elliot, fuck you. Fuck you, fuck your entire existence, and also to all the incels that simp over to you as well, I hope you all go fuck yourself and you can all watch me suck my own fucking dick, you cum-guzzling retards. So, what'd you think about this video? Did you like it? Did you dislike it? Do you like Elliot Rodger for some reason? Are you an incel? If so, fuck you. And if you don't like incels, or if you're in incel recovery trying to make the best possible life choices, I congratulate you. And guys, really, thank you all so much for sticking around me for all this time, for like the past 10 years. I never thought that, you know, I would still be making videos for like a decade. And I really hope for another 10 years to come. And also, please guys, if you have the time, please recommend me to all your friends and family. Subscribe to my channel. I really want to get up that 3K mark. Again, I really don't ask that much, but again, you're all be like,
you ask a whole lot.
Please, I just really want to make a fucking milestone. So that is all I gotta say, and stay tuned for more videos to come. Without further ado, ladies and gents, I am Atticus the Death Meller. Hope you like this video, subscribe to my channel, links are down in the description below. Keep it metal, stay safe, stay healthy, and happy 10 years of Atticus the Death Meller. Prost. Tell me.